That's another group of the common conditions which we deal with. Another major group of the conditions which we generally deal with in the clinical practice would be alcohol-related psychological and physical disorders. Now, I have included the physical disorders also in the discussion because it's a very close combination of psychological and the physical disorder. Alcoholism or consumption of regular alcohol is now considered as a psychological condition. And in DSM-5 classification, the alcohol, it's not only related to alcohol, all substance-induced psychotic disorders. Of course, these days, the other substances like the other drugs also are becoming more common. But majority of the patients, of course, are of the alcohol-dependent conditions. When a patient would have a hallucinations or delusions produced due to the drug consumed as such, they are to be considered as a substance-induced psychotic disorder. This is as per the DSM-5 classification. But I think we need not limit to that kind of a specific definition of going into the delusion or hallucination. A person who feels like going for the consumption of the alcohol by himself and who cannot just avoid the alcohol by himself can be considered as an alcoholic, and it can be considered as a psychological conditions as such, psychiatric conditions as such, which needs to be intervened. And delusions or false ideas also could is another characteristic of the psychological conditions as per the DSM-5 classification. I think that criteria is not absolutely necessary as such. Alcohol consumption, according to Ayurveda, is not to be considered as a illness in every condition. Now, according to Ayurveda, alcohol is compared to visha. At the same time, consumption of the alcohol in a healthy form or in a limited form is also suggested as something which is good for the health asset. So that limitations have to be understood. I'll try to make out that what's the difference and what makes the difference. From the current our situation, clinical point of view, consumption of the alcohol in India is increasing rapidly based upon the market statistics. By 2020, 6.53 billion liters of alcohol are consumed in India, and majority of them are the strong drinks asset. State-wise distribution of that alcohol, the top alcohol consuming states in the list asset, based upon the market statistics, Tamil Nadu, Punjab, Karnataka, and Karnataka is in the third place. So anyway, that's about the consumption of alcohol and existing practice. Now, compared to the global situations, there are certain issues which are specific to the Indian context. The share of population who never drink alcohol, based upon the statistics taken in 2010, so probably the ratio would be almost similar. Interesting is, in India, the persons who are absolutely non-alcoholics or who never consume alcohol, they are comparatively quite large numbers. Now, the number of, as per the, now I think you can see the graph, the color code, a darker green color suggests about higher percentage of persons who never drink alcohol. And India comes under that numbers. So number of people who never drink alcohol are also a relatively large number, but at the same time, the consumption of alcohol is one of the major cause of illness in India compared to other countries. Reason, of course, I try to deal with that. Of course, traditionally based upon the Charaka Samhita, madhya is considered as compared to anna, kintu madhyam swabhavena yathaiva annam tatha smritam. As long as it is taken with a proper situation. But that consumption of the alcohol should not be interpreted as the alcohol which can produce toxicity. But it's about the medicines. Your asava, aristas which have consumed alcohol, they are the conditions or they are the references which are mentioned in the text as the madhya varieties. Whereas same madhya, which is consumed with the ayukti yuktam rogaya, when it's not consumed with the proper reasoning or proper this control, then it can become the disease as such. Now, when I say that never drink alcohol, probably those people who consume these asava aristas, they are not included in this, but it relates to the alcohol consumption, which is consumed as the addiction as such. The another important aspect, the other way, from the same statistics, when it comes to the question of alcohol, where the these stronger alcohols, like stronger beverages of the alcohol, unlike that of the beer and so on, when it comes to that, India has the highest number. The majority of the people who consume alcohol in India, they consume those stronger liquors. Now, that's a very paradoxical situation. Number of people who do not consume alcohol also are more. And among those people who consume alcohol, majority of the people, they consume stronger alcohol. And hence, as when it comes to the statistics of alcohol-related diseases, incidence in India is quite high. I am not saying that it is the maximum in India, but it is quite high. And hence, when it comes to the question of practical clinical conditions, alcohol-related issues, they become a quite critical issue as such. Now, when the alcohol has to be considered as toxic, there is a standard protocol. Now, this is from our traffic, our law, the person, traffic police, when they assess the breath analysis and how they consider whether you are an alcoholic or not, or the grading of the alcohol consumption is based upon that breath analysis test. When it is less than 100 milligram per dl, it's considered as moderate, whereas when it is more than 300 milligram per dl, it's considered to be quite severe as such, and it's related to the number of drinks also. I think we'll not go into that detail. Now, when it comes to the clinical hand issues, the one of the common issues would be whether the person can be helped to stop the alcohol habit or not. It happens quite frequently that the patient may not be interested in stopping the alcohol, but his family members would come and then ask for some medications and so on. And of course, there are a large number of these published, maybe not official, not scientifically, but other way, materials which are presented as something which can be added to the food and then the person would stop the alcohol. The de-addiction drugs, they are even prescribed medically as well as without that proper medical channel. These are used as such in the commercial field. Lots of publicity would be given to such medicines or such interventions. But I don't suggest any of those. One of the important issues is, unless the person makes up a definite mind, like, or he considers that there is a need for stopping the alcohol and he is motivated, the addiction cannot be stopped. So, is attempting to stop the addiction, unless the person is motivated, would be quite difficult. And the best of the method to have the motivation would be, of course, counseling by any person, but a better motivation would be, it's now proved, like a group motivation is always suggestive. Group motivation is, now there are large number of such groups which are present in the society. Many of these programs are there. One of the very established program is the Rural Development Program of Sri Kshetra Dharmasthala, where a comparative model of Alcoholic Anonymous is established, where persons who were alcoholic addicts and now they have stopped alcohol, they are made to motivate the persons who are alcoholics. Now, that kind of a motivation by a person who was alcoholic earlier and then he has stopped and then he establishes the advantage of stopping the alcohol, that would be the best of the motivation to stop the alcohol consumption. So, I don't suggest any medical treatment for such. Instead, I would just recommend the patient to go into such groups. Of course, Alcoholic Anonymous is an international organization where a similar situation, where the person is made to deal with the alcoholic consumptions and even on the website. Now those who are of the present day generation, who may not feel like going to a village or going to a group of personally, you can have an anonymous setup. A website also is there where you can register, and with that there could be a chatting with the persons who are alcoholics. Methods of and advantages of stopping the alcohol can be suggested, and that gives a good results. I have seen many of the people who could stop the alcohol by being a member of Alcoholic Anonymous. Of course, the other aspects where the de-addiction could be done would be having a proper family atmosphere. Medications, I would consider them as a definitely not successful. But common medicines which are prescribed are disulfiram, which is an anti-abuse, anti-abuse drug. Now what happens is, I have seen a large number of people who are consuming disulfiram and they consume alcohol and they would have vomiting and lots of illness, and the person is brought to us with that illness as a presenting symptom. And many times you would be getting confused, like what has produced the illness. If a person is on alcohol, alcohol de-addiction, anti-abuse drug, very often what happens is a member of the family would be giving this disulfiram tablet along with the food also, without really making the patient aware of it. It's kept as a secret. And the person consumes alcohol, and then he will have lots of severe ill feeling, nausea, vomiting, and high temperature, and so on, many times uncontrolled behavior. And when such a person is brought to you, definitely you will be confused, like whether it is is the real cause as such. And a large number of patients are of that category. And prescription or administration of this disulfiram is kept as a secret, and only at the end, maybe of dealing with the patients, some members of the family secretly will come to you and say that this person is given such and such medicines and so on. And then you will have a real problem in the clinical practice. I have seen many of such patients where such kind of irritations have occurred. Though it may not be fatal, but the complaints are quite severe, and the management could be, of course, the patient has to be given IV fluids, glucose has to be given. Then only the patient can be managed somehow, or you have to wait for at least 1 or 2 days for the symptom to subside. With that anti-abuse drug, I don't think that it will be really successful in large number of persons, but maybe if a person has a motivation already, then disulfiram can help him to stop the alcohol, or any of these drugs. Any of these drugs which are otherwise are used in the practice regularly would be useful only when the person has a motivation, and then he still has some urge for consumption of the alcohol. Any of these drugs can help. But if a person is not motivated, de-addiction virtually is not possible. And I don't suggest any of the medicines for that. Instead, I would suggest the patients go for a motivation programs as such. Now, when there is a need for medical intervention, would be in acute alcoholism or acute alcohol binge as such, where person has consumed a large amount of the alcohol, and then he is presented with the clinical symptoms of either stupor, coma, and so on. Acute alcoholism is a practical clinical problem where, of course, the stages of alcohol, the effects, they are categorized as the 7 categories in the present day situation, starting from sobriety, euphoria, excitement. These 3 conditions may not require a medical intervention. But 4th, 5th, 6th, confusion, stupor, and coma, they require a medical intervention. Of course, the last stage is death, where there is no question of medical intervention as such. Ayurvedic point of view, too, the alcohol or mada, alcohol effects, they are categorized into 4 categories, and they are almost similar to the same method or which is described in the present day situation. So medical intervention in acute alcoholism, where the person would have a stupor or coma, would be only the treatment has to be, you have to give IV fluids, glucose has to be given, and maybe at times vitamin thiamine also has to be given. That's the only treatment in such conditions. There is no other medical management I would suggest in case of acute alcoholism. Or of course, the other way is time. So hydration with the glucose is the only means of treating a patient with the severe acute alcoholism as such. That's one. Another common adverse effect which we see due to the alcohol would be the hangover symptoms. Persons who have consumed alcohol and then next day they would have the symptoms. These they will come to the clinical practice, clinical setup for the management, and common symptoms are fatigue, headache, and the muscle aches, nausea, or abnormal sleep, and so on. These are the conditions where I would be prescribing Sutashekara Kamaduka Vipatikara Churna because they are produced to Pitta Prakopa Janitani. Charaka has categorized this as a Pitta Prakopa produced to the Pana Adhmanam Udgiranam Amlarasaha Vidaha Adhirnasa Panajanitasya Vadantilingam. These are the Panajanita Lingas which need to be treated, and it's to be treated with the Pitta Prakopa Lakshanas. And my prescription would be Sutashekara Kamaduka, and it gives a good results as such. Another of the condition which we see rarely, though not frequently, is alcoholic ketoacidosis, which is a relatively a medical emergency condition where the person has a heavy drinking for quite a long time, and then the stop alcohol is stopped abruptly. Person who has become addicted to alcohol and consumes a large amount of alcohol, and sudden stoppage of the alcohol, and then the patient would have a ketoacidosis. This is a quite difficult condition where the patient would have nausea, vomiting, severe abdominal pain, and tachypnea, hypothermia, hematemesis, all complicated conditions can occur. And in these conditions, the management would be, it's a considered as a medical emergency. It has to be maintenance of the pH. The body pH has to be maintained by IV fluids. Usually, preference would be Ringer's lactate. Occasionally bicarbonate also has to be supplemented, and thiamine is required. I don't consider that we can manage with only with our prescriptions. If at all our prescriptions have to be given, I will be preferring Aarogyavardhini Kamaduka Kumari Vasava only after the patient's condition is stabilized. And these are mentioned in text as the Madatyaya, where you will have all the same symptoms like Bahupralapa, Hikka, Shwasa, or even the Chardi, Arochaka, and even Murcha. These are the typical symptoms of the Madatya, and these could be considered as Asadhya without the IV fluids. So IV fluids are mandatory in that condition when the patient develops the ketoacidosis. Then the Paramada is alcohol withdrawal. Now the basic difference between alcohol withdrawal symptoms and ketoacidosis is ketoacidosis is an acute medical emergency, whereas withdrawal symptoms are relatively milder symptoms where the patient would have a nausea and vomiting, diaphoresis, sweating, agitation, headache. These are very common, or in a very prolonged condition it could be a tremens delirium. That's a delirium tremens where a person would have tachycardia, hypertension, and body temperature is raised as such. Now in these conditions, of course, it's named as a paramada in Sushruta, where it could be either kapha pitta javyadi, shleshmotshaya, angagruta, virasasyadata. These are the typical conditions, presentations there. And the prescription would be, my prescription would be Smitsagara Kamadunda Sarasudharista, and occasionally Teladhara and Matrabas. These are relatively chronic conditions where you will have a long time intervention required, and the response is usually good if the patient has stopped the alcohol consumption further. But all these patients need to be watched for and investigated for a hepatic damage. And if there is a hepatic damage, then it needs to be treated as such. Another group of the patients who present in the clinical practice would be of a chronic alcoholism consequences. The chronic alcoholism is when a person has to consume alcohol every day and he becomes dependent upon that. And when the quantity is more than 100 ml per day, it's considered as a chronic alcoholism, and the complications could be of different varieties, where it's suggestive of exactly the damage to the body, the hepatic damage, and the patients would present with the gynecomastia or all that features of the chronic hepatic failure, testicular atrophy, even established cirrhosis of the liver. Pregnant women becoming alcohol alcoholic consumption, these addicts, they can result in a fetal having that fetal alcoholic syndrome, which is quite severe, and the child at the newborn condition itself, there could be hepatic pathology. The characteristic feature of a newborn having that fetal alcoholic syndrome would be having that the typical facial expression, where comparatively small eyes opening, and the wider the phylum or smooth phylum as such, where there will be no nasal bridge seen. Upper lips being thick, these are the typical facial expression. Of course, comparatively, we do see very rare conditions of the fetal alcoholic syndrome comparatively. But chronic alcoholism resulting in hepatic pathology are quite common, where there could be established hepatic pathology, including even established cirrhosis. Management of cirrhosis in detail, think we have discussed in other contexts, but in general, the prescription, unless the patient has established cirrhosis, a chronic hepatic pathology, my prescription would be Arogyavardhini Kamaduga Kumari Aswara. And Shirodhara and Rajayapanabhasthi also is prescribed usually in such conditions, which can help in at least pulling on the status. I don't consider that once there is a hepatic damage, it would be possible to reverse the condition. Most of the times it becomes irreversible once there is a fatty degeneration. And the other complications of the alcoholism, where it could be all that patients can present with other severe diseases of the alcoholism, gastrointestinal like established cirrhosis of the liver, peptic ulcer disorders, gastritis, pancreatitis, even carcinoma, cardiovascular conditions, hypertension, cardiomyopathy, atrial fibrillation. I am not going to deal with those issues because we have already dealt with these issues in other contexts. Important is a patient presenting with any of these disorders like gastrointestinal, cardiovascular, neurological, immunologic, before you make a final diagnosis, it's quite important that you need to take a detailed history of the alcoholism and keep one option of the possibility that the disease could be triggered due to alcoholism. And of course, the approach to the management will be based upon that primary important disease condition like a peptic ulcer, you have a specific management. But at the same time, something has to be done with the alcoholism. Withdrawal of the alcoholism, wherever possible, is one of the basic approaches. One condition where the person becomes totally addicted to alcohol and virtually it will never be possible to reverse the condition would be when it becomes a personality disorder, a avoidant personality disorder. It's also classified by DSM as a condition where a person exhibits more than four of these set of the symptoms, where patient would be avoiding his occupational activities, doesn't go for the job, is unwilling to get involved with the people unless he is certain of being liked. So he will not mix up with every person, he will be just mixing with only a few of the persons as such, and doesn't have an intimate relationship with any of the people, and has all social situations he will be either rejecting or will be criticized, and he has inhibited interpersonal situations. So there will be an established personality disorder, and in that condition, virtually the treatment would be impossible. It becomes irreversible. So in my practice, I avoid those patients. Of course, the contemporary psychiatric treatment, of course, many of the psychoactive drugs are often prescribed, and I do not prescribe any of those medicines, but I have seen the patients where these drugs are prescribed and virtually with very minimal or no advantages as such. So that's about the as such conditions. If the patient is insisting on the treatment, I would be prescribing Chandrakurva, Saraswarsha, Takradara, Rajayapanabhasthi, but I don't ensure that the results would be very satisfying. So once the patient has a chronic alcoholism which results in a personality disorder, it becomes virtually difficult or impossible to treat that condition. Now, next set of the psychiatric conditions which we often see in the clinical practice are premenopausal or postmenopausal syndromes, which also are categorized as psychiatric conditions, again quite common. In the premenopausal stage, the patients who have menstrual irregularities, prolonged heavy menstruation, etc. Whereas postmenopausal, hot flushes, cold sweats, and mood abnormalities, they can occur. In these conditions, the treatment would be specific to that Raja Kshaya or Rasa Kshaya, Raja Drishti or Rasa Kshaya. But at the same time, there has to be some management related to the psychiatric issues also. But I don't suggest any psychiatric treatment otherwise. Counseling is one of the important issues. Patient has to be ensured about the possibility of such conditions due to the menopause, age-related conditions. Once the patient accepts that, many of the patients can be managed better. But and then the pranayama and regular exercises also help a lot in dealing with these conditions. But prescription otherwise, in a menopausal condition, considering all that whole issue, as Rajakshaya, my prescription should be Chandraprabha, Punarnamandra, Draksavista, or Shatavari Rasayana occasionally. Now, these are not prescribed considering this as simply psychiatric illness. It's about the physical disorder present with the psychiatric symptoms, and it's not for a specific psychiatric management. Then, another of the condition is schizophrenia. Though it's becoming now comparatively common, but there is a important legal issue when we deal with the case of schizophrenia. So schizophrenia is considered as a major illness, and it has to be treated with the Mental Health Act conditions only with established psychological setup. So dealing with the schizophrenia primarily as a general clinical practitioner is not advisable from the legal safety point of view. But still, we need to deal with the patients of schizophrenia in the one or other way. And I will be dealing with only that aspect where we can deal with these patients of schizophrenia, not as a primary dealing with the treatment of schizophrenia. Now, schizophrenia are categorized into mainly four categories: positive symptoms, negative symptoms, cognitive or mood symptoms, based upon the clinical presentation. And these are exactly what the disease of Unmada are mentioned, and the types of Unmada are mentioned. The types of Unmada according to Sushruta would be according to Dosha, Vataja, Pittaja, Kapaja, and the Dukkha or Manasa or Visha, or even it could be Visha. Six varieties of Unmada are mentioned. Now, in a positive category, it is the patient who have hallucinations, which are usually auditory. And these are typically seen in case of Pittaja Unmada. Exactly, the clinical symptoms of Pittaja Unmada are the same, where the person would have an agitated behavior. Negative symptoms, where the person would have a reduced emotional range and have relatively silent, these are the typical features which we see in Kapaja Unmada, where the person would be secluded, like having a lesser activity. Patients with cognitive symptoms, these are typically seen in case of Manogata Unmada, where due to psychological disturbances, manasa causes, certain specific causes which have triggered in, the previous psychiatric illness has triggered in Unmada, these are usually representing with the cognitive symptoms. These are exactly the same which are mentioned in the Samhita and the same symptoms. The mood symptoms are usually in case of Vataja Unmada, where the person would have unstable mood conditions as such. The of course, the to consider a patient as a psychiatric schizophrenia or not, the DSM classification says that there should be a minimum criteria, and the minimum criteria is it has to have at least two of following symptoms, like delusions, hallucinations, etc. And the basic according to Ayurveda, it's about the involvement of the dosha. It's a physical disorder. It's not only manasika alone. Of course, there is a involvement of the manasika, but primarily it's due to the doshas which have gone in the upper aspect as it. So it's a physical illness which has become presented as a psychiatric symptom, and it's categorized as manasa vyadhi, but there has to be scope for minimal physical involvement treatment as it. Now, according to our text as it, the basic treatment could be shodhana. In all the unmada, shodhana has to be given. And shokashalyam yapaneyad unmade panjame. Shokashalya has to be removed by a proper counseling or the vidhi chikitsa. There you will have all that, the philosophical approaches. These are the suggested treatment. But practically, from the clinical point of view, as I told already, I try to avoid those conditions for primary treatment because of one, the legal issues, and another is the results are not very consistent. And one of the important issues is a patient who is already on an antipsychotic drug. To withdraw the drug is quite dangerous. Many times there could be severe aggravations. So psychoactive drugs, particularly used in schizophrenia, it will be quite difficult. When a patient is already on the antipsychotic drugs and then they prefer some ayurvedic treatment, usually I prescribe Smritsagara Sarasvarista or Takradhara and Virechana along with the existing treatment, which can help in to a certain extent to minimize the issues as such. But as the other way, the adverse effects of these drugs also are quite significant, and commonly used drugs are these primary groups of the drugs, chlorpromazine and so on, which are relatively less prescribed now, whereas most of the prescriptions are the second generation drugs, where it could be antiprobosol and so on. These would have quite significant adverse effects, and as I told you, it will be quite difficult to withdraw those drugs, and the adverse effects are mainly of different drugs. Now I have just put in that depending upon the type of the drugs, which are the adverse effects are which are commonly seen. Anticholinergic effects and dyslipidemia, extrapyramidal symptoms, they occur quite frequently in high-potency drugs. Most of the high-potency of primary generation drugs, this would be the most common. Management would be usually what I manage, how I deal with these patients with the anticholinergic effects. They would be presenting with the tachycardia, dryness of the mouth and so on. Along with the pre-existing drug, I would be prescribing Draksharista and Sudhashekara, which can reduce these adverse effects significantly. Patients with the dyslipidemia, where the cholesterol level would be quite high, particularly even low density lipids also tend to become quite high. Aarogyavardhini Kumari also helps to a certain extent. I don't say that it's an assured treatment, but it can reduce symptoms. And in case of the extrapyramidal tract symptoms, which are most common, where the person would have tremors and these abnormal lip movements, so on, and the gait is altered, my prescription would be Smritsagara Ekangavira, Tailadhara and Matradasti, which gives more dependable results. And I highlight on that part, like I would not try to withdraw those drugs. In a schizophrenia, withdrawal of the drugs would be quite difficult as such. Then in hyperprolactinemia, patients who have reduced libido, infertility as a clinical symptoms, usually my prescription would be Makaradvaja, but the results are not predictable, not very reliable, but certain of the patients would feel better with that prescription. And the patients would have neuromalignant disorder, neuroleptic malignant disorders, comparatively rare, where the person would have a high fever, rigidity, altered consciousness. It's a life-threatening emergency and virtually very little scope for any ayurvedic treatment. It's an emergency condition where you need to have life support treatment as such. Then postural hypotension, my prescription would be Ashwagandha Arista Chandra Prabha as the usual prescription as such. Then a patient with the cardiac abnormality where the ECG shows a prolonged QT interval, my prescription would be Prabhakaravati, which is primarily a cardiac pathology. Having seizures, patients having seizures with the schizophrenic drugs, anti-schizophrenic drugs, it's a very complex situation. It needs evaluation and maybe a change of prescription. The drug may have to be changed. So it's a very complex issue. Dealing with the person who is an antipsychotic drug presenting with a seizure, to give a simple prescription would be quite dangerous. Then, of course, patients who have sedation, feeling sleepy, usually the prescription would be macarbolide. Type 2 diabetes mellitus, weight gain, I don't suggest any other specific management. It's as we treat with diabetes mellitus or any other conditions. With this, let me conclude. I have not dealt with the psychiatric diseases as a psychiatrist. I have tried to touch with the topic, considering this from the point of view of a general clinical practitioner. And the basic issue are concept of manas in Ayurveda has a strong foothold. So description of manas in Ayurveda is much better than what the present psychiatrists or physiologists have understood. Self-awareness is the best method to prevent and manage psychological disorder. So dhi dhairya atmadhi vijnana, these are the best methods. So those who have that dhi dhairya atmadhi vijnana would not develop psychological disorder. And the other important issues which I have tried to make sensitized would be the legal provisions related to mental health. We need to be aware of that. Over-prescription of anxiolytics and antipsychotics is a practical clinical problem where definitely from Ayurvedic practice point of view, we have some area where we can produce a significant change. Majority of the adverse effects of psychiatric prescriptions can be effectively managed with the Ayurvedic protocol. With this, let me conclude. Thank you, and I would expect some questions.